Happy Saturday, everybody. Welcome to another edition of TD4 Sign Language Radio. Your host, Dr. Danny Purcell, coming from the campus of California State University at Dominguez Hills Booth campus. And as you can tell, I'm hoarse today. I apologize, but welcome to session 10 we're going to get through today. If you have to shoot me, you can. Actually, I was sitting down with Chautauqua campus yesterday in this holiday, and it's the first time I've ever gone into a holiday inn where before you enter, there was a sign that said, no guns. And so I thought, okay, I'm going to leave when I got up the door. I thought that was fantastic. I hope you're all doing great. I'm so apologize that I said, I'm going to get Demi Moore up here. I could do a different voice all day. Maybe that's what we're going to do. But it's ironic because today we're talking about speaking and listening in English. And I really need your phone calls. I need to encourage you to speak less of you speaking, more of you speaking. It's always a good thing. So give us a call at 1-800-339-1193. Again, 1-800-339-1193. Or send us an email at dhtv.csudh.edu. And I'm trying to show you a lot of videos today because I can't even listen to myself. I shoot this guy. Spring break starts next week for those of you that are students at Cal State doing it, so it's not a lot of you aren't. And we welcome you. You don't have to be enrolled in the class, participate in the class. We get a lot of great phone calls from people all out there. This is a class all about language acquisition, how we teach our ESL students. So give us a call at 1-800-339-1193. Today we're focusing on speaking and listening. That is what we're all talking about. We were talking all about, language acquisition, stages of second language acquisition, characteristics of effective second language instruction, and how to best facilitate second language instruction for our ESL students. Now, for those of you that are enrolled in the course, just a reminder, next week, we will not have class. Next week is, Easter break, and I hope you all have a wonderful Easter break. We'll be back here live in 2 weeks on the 10th. And for those of you that are enrolled in the class, just make sure you're on your fourth assignment and all the syllabuses is due next week. But I screwed up the spring break on the syllabus, so you're going to make that class profile individual student assessment is due on Saturday the 10th. And a couple of you emailed me asking, what if you don't actually teach right now? Folks, here's all that matters to me. I'm not as concerned about the products that you produce. You're my customers. I want you to get something out of this class. For me, it's my form. I'm important. And you understand the process. How I collect information to find out data about different students, how to find out data about the demographics of my school, the test scores of my school, things like that. Where do I find different types of tests? Do I have to use any district mandated tests? Can I create my own test? These are all the types of questions I want you to ask yourself. The product is very secondary. I think I'm getting clear in here. As long as you do the work and turn it on, being on time, you got your A, folks. I don't want the grade to motivate you. I want you to be motivated because you're in, so you want to learn something. And I think a lot of you are responding really well to that. Getting some of you are just going well above and beyond what I would have ever expected you to do. And I hope that all of you feel like doing that is going to make you a better teacher. That's what we're in the business of, is producing better teachers. And teachers who just have a hard time, and saw that there's now another school shortage where they're going to fire all the teachers in this school. Folks, teachers are not the problem. There's some bad teachers out there, but to think that all the teachers at a school are the reason that school's failing, that's just ridiculous, folks. There's so many other problems, and it's really easy for people to point and say, well, it's because of bad teachers, or because they don't have enough tests, and things like that. It's a real simplistic notion, and I wish people would just put that nonsense behind us. We all have to be in the business of really helping out our kids, and I think the best way to help out our kids is to produce happy kids, because happy kids produce happy parents, and happy parents come from California. So that's what we're in the business of doing. So we're talking all about speaking and listening. And so our goals for this session, by the end of this session, you will understand the importance of developing ESL students' literacy in English. Literacy is a fantasy educational term for speaking and listening. Recognize stages of ESL students' listening and speaking skills in English, and we'll understand a variety of ways to promote English or seen in our classrooms. So here's another question that we get on here, some phone calls, all of you. The question is, how do you encourage students to speak English in your classroom? And how do you encourage students to speak English in your classroom? Just call 1-800-339-1193, again, 1-800-339-1193, or send us an email, dhtv.csudh.edu. I'd rather get phone calls today. I don't want to hear you. I don't want to hear me. Okay, so let's jump right into it. Literacy in English, learning to listen and speak, makes it possible for students to succeed in school. It precedes everything else. This is providing our foundation. And just because a kid ain't talking in your classroom doesn't mean they're not learning. You know, a lot of times, you got that kid in the front that answers every single question or every converse someday, you know. Doesn't mean that kid's learning any more than the unibomber sitting in the back of the room. A lot of times, that unibomber sitting in the back of the room, that kid's learning more than everybody else because those ears are wide open. They're just going to sit there. You know, I've had a lot of kids do the same for instance, in September. By April, you can get them to stop talking. You know, so you have to recognize and appreciate that a lot of our students, not just ESL students, I think we've gotten that from this class. It's good for ESL students, it's good for all students. You know, this is what makes you a better teacher, is by working with ESL students. You're going to notice some ways to individualize instruction that will benefit all students. Just because they ain't talking doesn't mean they're not learning. And we need to appreciate those differences and celebrate those differences. This past week, I was in Oklahoma City in Wichita speaking, and I had so many questions about, well, I have some kids that do this and some kids that do that. How do I make sure to not make them feel like they're different or whatever? I take exactly the opposite approach, folks, is I point out to all my kids how different all of them are. I think we should be celebrating these differences. I mean, that's why I love Los Angeles. We have all these differences. We shouldn't all be alike. You know, some of your kids are great readers, and some of your kids are great mathematicians, and some of your kids are great line monitors, and some of your kids are great organized. You know, you need to praise and encourage your students, point out all of their strengths, and you know what, those, all of us have weaknesses. It's not a bad thing to point out weaknesses and challenge people to take steps to make those weaknesses and strengths. I actually celebrate all of the differences of all my students. I've never understood why people have a problem with all those differences. I think that's something that's a wonderful thing. I think one of the best ways to promote world language is to expose them to all the world language. So to me, a loud classroom is a great classroom. It should be loud and chaotic. And there are already ones that if things seem under control, you're just not going fast enough. I think a great language classroom anyway should be lots of talking and stuff. It doesn't necessarily mean that kids are talking to the entire class. Get your kids talking to one another. You know, I agree with my friend and mentor Stephen Grierson for USC. He says, you know, in one of his final hypotheses, he said you really should pay attention. A lot of times, a kid that doesn't say a word during class, you should watch that kid on the playground and in lunch at the cafeteria. That kid's probably the one talking the most. You know, we should be talking because it doesn't matter if they're talking in their first language. It's a good thing. We know that children that come from homes where lots of talk is taking place are much better in school. It doesn't matter what language is being spoken at home. We had this discussion a couple weeks ago about English only versus bilingual education, and I think both sides, we saw some really good points of view on both of those sides. And, you know, it's interesting. It's kind of like this healthcare debate that just took place. It's, I don't think the sides are as opposite as they think they are. I think there's a lot of common ground there, and I think any of us could actually argue from merits to bilingual education and from merits to English only. You know, it was interesting because I was just in Oklahoma. I was at a bar the other night drinking in class in Oklahoma. And this guy was like, well, you know what bothers me? People come to this country and they need to learn English. And it's amazing to me that you still have that opinion everywhere. And I understand that. And I think that we can all accept that. You know, I think all of us can agree that English is important. I think all of us need to celebrate English as a great language. It's definitely an important language for business, for school, definitely in the American public education system. I don't think, though, that we have to force English at the expense of students' native languages. I think we should celebrate those native languages as well. I think that we should be promoting those types of things. I think it's really strange to see all these teachers in classrooms that perhaps they speak and like J.J. Rugg and those things. I don't know that these signs are opposite people. Make them out to be somebody else to think all of you. So we finally got a photo of them all. Let's see who we got on the line. We have, let's see. We have Albert off Los Angeles. Thanks again for calling. Albert, how are you today?
Yeah, how are you?
Fantastic. I'm so sorry about my voice. Let's hear your voice. What can I do for you?
I want to answer that question. I think, okay, the best way to get your kids talking is to dramatize all their lessons and stage the debate so that they can participate.
Oh, you're talking about there, Oliver, with the dramatization. I agree with you. I think unless you're making your lessons memorable, you're wasting your time. Those things that you do to dramatize your lessons, Oliver, and what age level of students are you teaching?
I'm not teaching right now.
Okay. Okay. So once you get in the classroom, what age level do you want to teach in? And what kinds of things do you think you do to try and dramatize those lessons?
I suppose I'm doing a third grade.
Okay.
Use the computer. They know the names of the things we're going to use, and so it's very easy to dramatize that book. And if you go to upper classes, like you're doing the reading, after the reading, they can start debating on the topic.
Absolutely. And I think it's a great idea, Oliver's getting the kids to engage in a great debate, and, especially when somebody you give kids background knowledge, you find out what they know about something, engage in a discussion like that. Thank you so much for calling, Oliver. I think those are great ideas. You keep on going. I love you when you call. I think that's one of the greatest things about living in Los Angeles. You get to encounter all these different beautiful accents. You just listen to some people talk forever. Absolutely wonderful. One of the things that I think is really important in promoting speaking and listening is that I constantly am reading aloud to my students and using some folks. We've already talked about this today. I think the most underutilized resource in our classrooms, all classrooms, kindergarten all the way up through college level, I hope that we use the poetry. I think poetry is one of the best ways to engage students and think what Oliver is saying. It's a great way to promote discussions and to dramatize things. Poetry is wonderful. With my little kids, I use poetry. I actually have all students. Every single class I've ever taught, I always read aloud at least 4 poems a day. Think about that, folks. If you're reading aloud 4 poems a day to your students over the course of 180 school days, you're talking, you've exposed your kids to over 700 poems. It doesn't take rocket science to figure out your kids are going to be better readers than most kids. It's because they've actually been exposed to a lot more different types of reading. Alan Simper, a great teacher over at Liberty, also teaches classes now at Loyola Marymount. He's a wonderful author, a great speaker too. Alan, he taught at Liberty School. He uses a lot of hip-hop and rap with his students. I think that's a wonderful way to encourage students to get excited about speaking and listening more in your classroom. So if you ever came to my classroom, the middle ones on Thursday, we call it Poetry Thursday. It's very kid-to-kid poem. I got this idea from Ray Bradbury, Fahrenheit 451, where kids where people all memorize books. So if you came to my class on Thursdays, kids actually became poems. It's also a great way to differentiate instruction. So you get, in first grade class, you get Jose, one of my non-readers, and he'd do something a little bit more basic. You show Silverstein poem, and he'd say, "Hi, I'm the sinner by Shel Silverstein. Mrs. Van Clark, the babysitter, I think she's a little bit crazy. She thinks the babysitter is supposed to sleep on the baby." And then you get one of my higher students, and she says, "I'm Mark Antony, Julius Caesar, by William Shakespeare. Friends, Romans, national in your ears. I have a very Caesar not to praise, and the evil that men do not to have, and the good not to torment their bones, so that be with Caesar. Which, my friend, loyal and just to be bought, Brutus is an honorable man." He said, "Rome writes 50 lines from Julius Caesar." You know where I got that idea? I got that idea from watching Kindergarten Cop. I saw Schwarzenegger, got his kindergartners to cry to Gettysburg address, and I thought, wonder if it's possible, you know what, if Ezekiel's capable of anything, actually anybody's capable of anything if you actually believe in them. Always remember that. So one of the best ways I think to promote speaking in singing classrooms is to really get the kids focused on poetry, those songs, lyrics to whatever the kids want to listen to. I mean, you know, that's a good thing about American Idol, you know, is you can sing it all over the place now. And of course, the program and language development builds on the language of children in grammar school. Now, all children know now those are some informal types of language. You need to also understand that kids, it's very important they understand the language of schooling too. Lisa Tobin, she's a wonderful researcher at Harvard. She wrote a great book called Other People's Children. And she stressed that one of the important things that teachers also have to bring out of their students is the ability to succeed in an academic language environment. We talked about this fall semester long, this difference between the basic interpersonal communication skills, playground talk, and the cognitive academic language proficiency, which is school talk. You know, and I think I've talked about it in here. I talk about it with my eighth graders, and it's like ESPN. Watch the way the coaches talk, watch the way the athletes talk. Athletes talk a little bit more playground talk, and that's fine. And the coaches talk a little bit more school talk, and that's fine also. And what you want to make sure that your students are prepared for is how to succeed in that environment where people talk in school talk format. Let's see. You want to encourage your students to speak in whatever language possible, but again, one of our goals is that the kids are able to achieve in English. So what are you doing to promote that the students actually speak in English? Well, you know, you don't have to force vocabulary down their throats. Letting students communicate in whatever way possible. Again, the point of all language is communication. Don't make fun of a kid because they're trying to communicate a point. You know, you don't have to sound really, I don't want to speak with my vernacular and sound almost like signaling. You know, you sound like when you're in a thing, you use lots of large words. No, I mean, use words that people understand. That's the point of all communication, is to communicate. You want authentic communication situations. You know, I see a lot of ESL classrooms, there's these voice dialogues where, you know, they're like, okay, at the grocery store, and we're going to do a grocery store where, I remember when I used to check out Berlitz tapes from the public library and help focus on my Spanish. And so I'd be driving to Compton on my way to work, and I'd be listening to these Berlitz tapes, and it would be like, allow me to introduce Mr. Jones. The man doesn't understand your rules. Allow me to introduce Mr. Jones. The man doesn't understand your rules. Like, you know, me and Los Angeles Jones is in Mexico doing it, but it was just a silly kind of forced dialogue or whatever. I learned a lot more Spanish by a urban kid who's like, maestro, yo quiero lonche. I'm like, lonche. Almuerzo? What time's lunch? What time's almuerzo? Almuerzo's at 11:15. We're just 3 hours from now, so sit your bunkies down and you're on Ciento and we're going to Aprende, right? Things like that. I'm losing my folks here. We got another phone call. Let's see who we got in line this time. We've got Luis Golf from South Asia. Thank you so much for calling, Luis. How are you today?
Good, Professor. Thanks for taking my call.
Thank you. What can I do for you, Luis?
I just remember that I used to work with a professor who used to play Beatles songs. He used to print out the lyrics and put them for everybody in class. And they used to just follow along to do Yellow Submarine. Everybody used to just sing along, and everybody was having such a good time, and it seemed to me like everybody didn't really realize that they were actually learning English words and a form of song, so I thought that was kind of interesting, especially because the Beatles are so popular. Nowadays, they have their own video game, and I just thought that was a really good method to teach them.
What grade level was that, Luis, that professor did?
Fifth
grade. Fifth grade, you know. Man, you need a whole bunch of fifth grade teachers like that. That is awesome, Luis. And, you know, so you have constant members of the fifth grade teacher.
Oh, of course. Yeah. I love to do it myself, so I used to just go ahead and sing along with them.
I think that's great. I think it's one of the best ways to build up fluency, too. I always use song lyrics. I think it's always funny for people to actually read slow literature. He was listening to a song and actually reading lyrics are two different things. I mean, have you ever read the lyrics to, I all read the lyrics to Bruce Springsteen songs to people. So if you read his song lyrics to Sissy Girl, there's no, she's a sexy girl, she's a sexy girl, she's a sexy girl, she's a very sexy girl. Wow, Bruce will be a girlfriend the best of Steve in his life. Exactly, for fifth graders, computers are a little bit harmless. Their submarine's great. It's great. The other thing that you were talking about, Louise, is everybody was reading it together, so there's the bonding, and everybody was laughing and comfortable.
Oh, yeah, these songs are like ingrained into your head once you hear them for the first time. And don't ever forget that, you know.
Yeah, I completely agree. That's the thing, it gets you great. Because then you can also, as a teacher, building up the lesson, you can do a preview by having the kids listen to the song, and you can all read the song together, and then you can listen to the song again, and all of you sing the song with the Beatles. That makes it for a wonderful lesson plan.
Exactly.
I just think that's
fantastic.
Absolutely. See, and you build an entire curriculum, and you get so many standards just with that one lesson. Thanks so much for all of you. I really appreciate that. You shared that. You call back anytime. I always love your tips. It's a good one, by Louise. I hope the rest of you can give some calls and talk about how you're promoting English in your class. We'll share a great memory like Louise just shared. You know, a great, wonderful teacher like that. You never forget those outstanding lessons. And that's one of the things I'm always trying to stress to teachers is how you make yourself memorable. What is that thing that you do every single day to make your lesson? Let's go back to vocabulary, learning English vocabulary. English language, you need to understand it has by far the largest vocabulary of any language in the world. I think number two is French is number three. I think French has about an enormous vocabulary of around 150,000 words. Number two is German, I think, has around 200,000 words in German vocabulary. Number one is English, which has well over a million words in its working vocabulary, and if you expand it to technical terms, scientific terms, it's well over 5-6 million words. The strength of English is the strength of America, it's stronger for its diversity. Now, the weakness of English is also the weakness of America. It's a mess when it comes to the rules because it accepts so many different things. These things contradict one another. Our language has evolved essentially. One of the reasons I always tell people you need to embrace immigration, not freak out over immigration. I mean, our country is a nation of immigrants, and the English language has been built up because of all of our immigrants. I mean, thank goodness, for example, for our immigrants from India, because if it wasn't for the language of Hindi, we'd all have a lot of dirty hair. The word shampoo is actually a Hindi word. Thank goodness for Arabic. Without Arabic, we would not have alcohol is the Arabic word. Thank goodness for Slavic languages like Russian and Polish. They gave us important words like stroganoff and vodka and robot. Now, he's known that John Norris and his friends, when the Norse invasions back in the 9th century in England, they brought in a whole bunch of Viking terminology into the English language. They brought in terms like anger, king, husband, and ugly. I've always been interested in if that was the order those words were introduced into the English language. Can you just imagine? I'm very angry. That's incredible. Or we want husband. He ugly. I've always been interested in that. Now, when the bosses came from France back in 1066, when the conqueror, he didn't only just conquer England, but literally for a couple hundred years, the French language conquered England linguistically for a couple of hundred years. I mean, we have a lot of influence from the French language. For example, none of us would have to pay taxes because of the French, because the word tax is actually a French term. None of us would watch Law and Order if it wasn't for the French, because almost every single courtroom term played to defend all these words are French words. We have nothing to read if it wasn't for the French, because words like poetry, history, stories are all French terms, and it all was an atheist, because the term religion actually came to us courtesy of the French. Now, Dances with Wolverines also had a huge impact on the English language. Now, when the English came and settled in the Americas and New Zealand and Australia, not only did they come and conquer, but there was all these native peoples here, and there was actually things here that they didn't have in England. So what they did is they just accepted the terminology. So, for example, they didn't have coyotes or kangaroos in Europe, and so they just accepted the words coyote and kangaroo. I don't know if you know this, but 26 of our 50 states are actually Native American terms. States like Florida, Illinois, Alabama, these are all actual Native American expressions. So there's been a huge evolution in the English language. We've already grown my vocabulary, so I've got to have my fascinating vocabulary. So we got the phone call to see if we got on the line. We got to stop again.
How are you doing, Mr. Bubba?
Fantastic. Thanks so much for calling this phone last. That was a great phone call. What can I do for you today?
I kind of wanted to respond to the question.
Great. Things like that. Oh, and the thing is, okay, my fabulous $200 activity fee will go 14,000 students here at the university, and it's reported that we're going to be about a deficit of about $5.8 million at the end of this year. If you were just to implement this one program that I've been advocating for 5 years, within 1 year, you would make almost $6 million for the university. And people even heard that for 5 years. Drives me nuts. It's amazing. It's that negative energy, and you see that in classrooms all the time when people are ignored. Nobody's going to offer an opinion if they're ignored. Now, contrast that with places where you see that teacher who's constantly listening to kids. I've shown you some teachers in here, Graves, with over and over in elementary, who listens to the feelings of his students.
Frustration in both the teacher and the student. It happens all the time. And I love to show those clips to teachers because I want you to realize all of us had that day. Well, while we were watching that clip, we had another phone call. Let's see what we have on the line right now. We have, let's see, we've got Colonel Walter Redondo being placed on this call. How are you today? You there, Bill?
I'm good. Good morning, Professor.
Great. What can I do for you?
Yes, I'm here. Many people have advocated simplifying English by
simplifying the spelling and the pronunciation. And the question was brought to mind by your comments about words from other languages that we have in English. And I was wondering if there's been any academic movement or movement in the education industry to try to adopt that to help English language learners.
Yeah, it's always a big thing. A lot of people are trying. Thank you for that question. It's a great question. People are talking about how you simplify the English language. And I don't know if it can actually be done. But like, especially when you get into phonetic spelling and stuff, because there's just too many conflicting rules out there. So I don't know if the movement's even. There's definitely movement for doing that, but you're absolutely right about that. There are people that advocate that all the time. I don't know if it's going to work all the time. And after all the things I have noticed, though, and you've probably noticed this too, Bill, there's been a big change in the last 20 years in this country with road signs. If you notice, road signs are starting to be a lot less wordy and a lot more picturey. They've gotten rid of a lot of the English on road signs, and it's all now like pictures because they've accepted the fact that there's a lot of people that have no clue how to read the English. And I don't know, and so then you have people that are against that. Also, so these are kind of interesting issues, but, you know, I know that English is a nightmare to try and learn, but I don't know if simplifying it through a spelling of things, I don't know if this is our best way of placing resources for people about it. What do you think, Bill?
Well, I think it's happening despite us because new spellings are creeping their way into the written language, into newspapers, but the way people write it. I see it more in foreign languages. For example, in Italian, the word blue is azzurro.
Yeah.
But I can read Italian newspapers, and when they refer to the color blue, then they spell it B-L-U. So I think English is creeping into other languages, and I think simplified spelling will creep into ours, but it probably just won't be generation.
Well, I think the other argument on this, Bill, is because of the influence of text messaging, and you see teens and email and things like that, that's really creeping into our language also. So just you brought up the newspapers, the mobile newspapers are starting to die out, and you're starting to see many more people blogging and the emoticons and things like that, where people tell me BFF, and I'm like, BFF, BFF you, and I'm like, BFF means best friends forever, you know, I didn't know that, and that's where I see a lot of the simplification of language, where it's creepy, and you're right, every single year, there's more and more of these words that are starting to just become the accepted norm, because that's the way people use them, so I think you're definitely going to see that kind of movement. I don't know if it's going to be as drastic as a lot of people want it to be, but you see that it's interesting to get pointed out, it's happening in other languages too, because it is, and I think that's basically, the strength of any language is the willingness to adapt. I think that's why English is probably kind of the big predominant language in the world. It's stringent about things as all the other languages. Thank you so much for that call, but that was a really cool call. You call back anytime. I want to think more about that too. It's actually, because that is kind of a movement that all goes online. I got an email from you. Thank you, Alina. Alina writes, I'm in third grade. Straight into English for language arts. My third grade teacher agreed to us, so give me a lot more third grade teachers like that. It was the first time someone read a novel to me. That's the first time in third grade. That's disappointing. She read us Secret Garden. It was awesome. That is an awesome book. And then she writes, the faculty is resisting change. That's great. And you know what? This next season, the faculty, this is, I don't know what it is. It's just amazing. It's frustrating though, because I understand that when I talk to teachers at their schools that make what seem to be fairly quaint recommendations and they're met with all these people saying, oh, that'll never work. So thank you so much for that email. John just emailed, thank you, John. John writes, hey, Danny, what do you do when you're using different ways to introduce language like the Beatles song and a student will participate? We always have fun kids that are going to participate, John. And I think it was in the video last week, the video clip of Rafe, and Rafe made this comment, which I really hope a lot of you picked up on. He said, make your class so awesome, so engaging, that punishment is not to be able to participate. So if you're really doing a great Beatles lesson, which I think Gustavus, who's a great teacher, probably was doing, and I know it wasn't yourself, but Louise is a great teacher. If you're doing that great engaging lesson, that is going to want to participate in that lesson. If they don't want to participate, that's fine. You know what? I don't force myself on people. You know, different strokes for different folks. You know, some kids just don't want to do that, and I'm not going to force them on that kind of thing. But, you know, I was going to make this point the other day with a group of teachers. There was a kid that wouldn't stand for the Pledge of Allegiance, and the teacher asked, well, what can I do? And I'll tell you what I do is, I've always said this to kids, is maybe you don't agree with the Pledge of Allegiance, which is fine. I mean, we live in America, there's lots of different beliefs in America. But out of the sign of common courtesy, when you're in a place where, like, if you're in the United States, people rise for the national anthem, common courtesy, human decency dictates that you stand with everybody else. You don't have to sing it or whatever. You should stand in respect. You know, when I'm in different countries, I always try to figure out what is the respectful thing to do. What am I supposed to do? There's a scene in Ben Hur, great movie Ben Hur. I don't know if you've ever seen Ben Hur. That's a fantastic job. It's a good one, Charlton Heston. But there's a scene in Ben Hur where he's eating with this sheik, and he finishes the big meal, and the sheik is like, you did not like my meal. He's like, no, I loved it. I'm satisfied. He's like,
that meal was one of the greatest meals ever.
And then he realizes that the custom is, when you play the meal, the custom is to belch. And so then Charlton tells the custom, he finally belches, and now the sheik is very happy. And, you know, in some cultures that would be easier to do, but when you're in that culture, you do it because that is the respectful thing to do. And that's all I ever try to train kids to do, is to, you know, there's one of the things I don't agree with, but I also believe in decorum. You know, it's kind of like Congress. It's kind of, I keep using Congress, but I hear all this name calling, like, shame on you guys. You can disagree, but you need to be civil when you disagree, because you're in an institution that's been there for 250 years, and that's the way it's done. You know, you don't shout out this thing to the President of the United States. That's just not the way it's done. You know, like who he is, but you still accept the fact that he's the commander-in-chief. You know, that's all I ever ask. It has nothing to do with anything, but, you know, that's just common decency. You accept whatever it is. If you're a guest somewhere, you accept their hospitality, and you show them the respect that they deserve. And I don't think it has to be a bigger deal than that. Okay, let's talk about the same processes. Exactly. I think I'm listening can be divided into different purposes. And I try to get kids to understand that we need to listen for specific things. So, for example, when we're listening for immediate comprehension, there's that silent period that you're going to have. But, you know, just because a kid, they can't respond to you orally, doesn't mean they can't participate. So I have lots of kids that, I'll be the person who's speaking actively, and they might not be speaking, but they can still be active. James Amsher came up with public discourse response, which we know in English means play silent says, I say, can everybody stand up? Can you all say stand up? Can you say stand up? And you all stand up? You know, but it's a lot of nonverbals at this beginning stage, and, you know, like, you ask questions, and kids can demonstrate understanding by pointing to things and gesturing. Things like that. You can have kids listen to audio tapes. Olivia was talking about she used to have a teacher in third grade that would read aloud The Secret Garden to her. I mean, reading aloud is one of the best ways to engage your students. I think actually, there's an activity I love to do. I'm getting ready for an activity to show you how to engage things, right? So, again, this picture right behind me, I'm going to engage you right now. All right, professionals, here's the activity. I'm going to read aloud a list of words. I want you to concentrate on this list of words. And then after I finish reading a list of words, I want you to write down as many words as you can remember. Alright? So I'm going to read aloud a list of words. And then after I finish reading aloud that list, I want you to try to write down as many words you can remember. Alright? So have your head on if you understand. Do you understand me? Okay? I'm going to listen very carefully. Pillow. Sheet, night, wake, doze, dream, night, relax, gift. Comfort. Sleep. Okay, write down as many words as you can remember right now. Write them down. Write down as many words as you think you can remember. If you want to, you can email me. Email me the words. That's dhtv.csudh.edu. Write down the words. Write down as many of the words you can remember. All right, let's see how many of those words you can remember. All right, let's see how many you got. All right, so I'm going to give you a little bit more time. I know this is awkward on TV. It's a little bit easier when you're on campus. I can see if you're writing or not. A lot of you right now are just scratching your saddles and drinking your coffee, but I hope you wrote down a list of words. All right, did you write down your list of words? Because I want to show you what I'm going to show you is how your brain's processing information. It's important for us, especially as teachers, to recognize this fact, because it's very important in how we engage our students, how we provide information that's meaningful to them. Okay, so hopefully you have a list of words. All right. Now, I want you to raise your hand at home if you wrote down the words pillow and sleep. Okay, if you wrote down pillow and sleep, I'm going to identify that's called the primacy and recency effect. Your brain tends to remember the first and last items when given a list of information. So, pillow was the first item I said, and sleep was the very last item I said. Okay, raise your hand. If you wrote down the word night, I bet you more of you raised your hand that time. That's called the repetition effect. I actually said the word night 3 times. The brain likes to hear information repeated to it all the time. Okay, raise your hand if you wrote down the word artichoke. I bet you almost all of you wrote down that word. That's called the surprise effect. Your brain automatically, without you thinking about it, classifies information. And when it finds something in a list of material that doesn't match the pattern, it puts that information in a totally different part of the brain, and it makes that part actually stick out. All right? And now, raise your hand if you go down the word bed. Okay? Now, that's called the false memory effect. I never said the word bed, but by showing you a picture of a bed and relating all the words on my list to a bed, a lot of you probably wrote down the word bed. Now, what can we learn from this activity about how we teach our ESLs? First of all, let's think about the primacy and recency effect. What that tells me is the first and last things that I teach every day are very important. Those tend to stick in kids' heads. So how are we opening up our days? How are we ending our days in our classrooms? Think about that. Now think about the repetition effect, the word night. Repetition effect is a very influential learning technique we've talked about in here. You know, repetition ain't a bad thing. You know, you don't want to be one of these teachers saying, oh, look, I'm so sorry, Mrs. Stick this in the third of the ad. Repetition's a good thing. I feel this way in here. There's certain points I'm repeating every single week just to get ingrained in your mind. Okay, now, the surprise effect, artichoke, that is very important. What are we doing to surprise our kids every single day? How do we get them to remember information? What's that moment that they always remember every single day? You know, maybe it's reciting Beatles songs. Maybe it's reading aloud to sing in your garden. What is it every single day that a teacher does to get that information into the kids' heads? I mean, if you look at Louise, they were talking about things that happened years and years ago, but they remembered it. There was a memorable experience. And then think about the false memory effect. You know, I think context is everything, and sometimes teachers will provide context that we think is going to help our kids, but in fact, it actually hurts our students. So how do we make it so we're not confusing our students? So I'm hopeful those are helpful as I'm doing that activity. This is really something from the beginning of the bridge, but we also listen to repeat. You know, one of the things that I'm constantly doing is the times when Louise's teacher was doing is you get kids doing lots of oral reading together, repeating. One of the best ways to do this is with chants. I usually chant with my kids all the time. I mean, chants take a very long time, but you're giving the kids plenty of vocabulary opportunities. So it would be like, right hand, left hand, give a little butter. Right hand, left hand, put them on your lap. Something like that. Or you can do, I do chants and you go, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, the days of the week, ahora en español, domingo, lunes, martes, miércoles, jueves, viernes, sábado, los días de la semana. Now you're doing hemorrhage. The reason I do that is because one of my favorite hobbies is to have yard duty and AC advising 150 students on the playground. There's always at least three kids that sit in their knee and they help to get like. It's all of the English and Spanish. I don't speak gibberish, but I need to work with kids at me while I was doing those chants. And I got an email from Jaime. Thank you for emailing Jaime Rice. And I gave this country when I was 11. It was really frustrating learning English. I had to manage it. But even now that I know English, I still have trouble pronouncing and distinguishing words like jello and yellow. That would definitely be tough. And to me, they sound the same, yeah, jello and yellow. That's the names I think that in hand for clip. Those would definitely be tricky because they're very, when you start mixing it with Spanish, the sounds sound the same. I'm sure that I was loved to hear those.
It's not easy. It really isn't easy, folks. Right now, facilitating listening for our students is get the kids to write responses to our questions rather than actually speaking, and they'd actually read it aloud. A lot of kids say the intense stuff if you're doing this. Well, that's not a big thing, folks. Very important to remember when you're trying to promote speaking and listening in your classroom, it doesn't mean using speaking for the entire class. I mean, get the kids speaking in pairs, in small groups. A lot of times they're much more comfortable around each other than with me. I mean, I freak kids out all the time. On the first day of school, Wednesday is open, Celsius, Celsius. She's like under the desk in the fetal position. My ass was on the aisle. You know, she had this big, huge white guy in the right of her face. You know, you can get some space. I need to make that comfortable environment that Gustavo was talking about. Alina writes again, thank you. And I think I can give my sample to the other side. Alina writes, referring to English creeping into other languages. Lonche, Droga are now common as Spanish, but they're made up good for almuerzo, lunch, lonche, and camioneta, truck, Droga. It's sad some Spanish speakers don't know they're speaking with made. And they stopped showing me an email. All right, so with me, I'm going to say with me out words. It's probably what she said. Thank you for that, Elena. Yeah, that's the Spanish when you start merging the different languages together. And actually, it really stood ill when he was talking about the simplification of English. It's saying a lot of that, though. In the simplification, there's kind of a merging of a lot of different languages. Just simple, make it simple. I see that all the time. All right. Or myself again, I've always thought that the best way to learn any language is singing. I love singing all the time. I can't sing very well today. Not that I can sing well usually, but today I really sound like a wounded duck. I wanted to show you, Dr. Seuss does get very better than Dr. Seuss. Dr. Seuss is just the master at using language to, he uses repetition, he simplifies things, so it's very personal. So here's just a clip from the Cat in the Hat by Dr. Seuss. It's actually one of my favorite books of all time. My little kids used to call Dr. Seuss Dr. A. Seuss, but we're going to enjoy this one. It's about a 5.5 minute clip from The Cat in the Hat by Dr. Seuss.
You're all small things. They're not things. They're and you are not a cat. Who ever heard of a 6-foot cat? But I have a cat. You're not a cat in a hat. That's not a hat. You're not a cat. And you are a...
I am indeed a cat. And this, indeed, is a hat.
In English, cat. Hat. In French, chapeau.
It really is quite obvious, don't you know?
English cat, hat, in French, chapeau.
Du twang, hat, sing.
Here we go.
I repeat, cat, hat, in French, chapeau. In Spanish, el gato in a sombrero.
He's a cat in a hat, he's a cat in a chapeau. He also wears a gato in a sombrero. Ole, 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 ole.
Chabot. He's Spanish and got no manners, so rare. And I'll tell you something more. Now you listen to me good. In Schopenhauer, I'm a consequence. He's better work. He says he's a consequence. Now, in your receptive state of mind, I'll recapitulate. Cat, hat, in French, chapeau, in Spanish, elgato, in a sombrero. In German, I'm a classy, in a wood, in Russian, I'm a clunky, in a bunker clunk. In Eskimo, you're a guanka in a bunker bunk in Eskimo, right?
In a guanka in a bunker bunk in Eskimo. Is a bunker bunk in Eskimo. Yana is a bunker bunk. Bunker 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 bunker. Yes, indeed, that is so. Is a guanka in a bunker bunk in Eskimo.
Now, to be certain that I have this mate, I'll recapitulate. Cat. In French, chachamau, cause in Spanish, you're a gato and a sombrero. In German, you're a gato, but I also know you're a gato and a bunga fucking Eskimo. By George, I think he's got it. Now, if you will allow me, sir, but take a look at me, I think that I can tell you what you are in Russian. What? Shabka, kushlapa, or a shabka in a shlapa. I am. Why, that's splendid.
I'm a
shot
in a shot. I'm a shot in a shot. I'm a shot in a shot. I'm a shot.
Watching the HD television program service on Colony State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, I'm Kathy Zimmer, Director of the University Art Gallery at California State University, Dominguez Hills. We are looking forward to an exciting study of exhibitions for the spring of 2010 and invite you to attend our exhibitionist events. Art of Ink, Traditional and Contemporary Calligraphy with Seal Images. Using symbols as written word, the wisdom and art of calligraphy remains one of the most revered, functional, and artistic traditions in East Asia. This exhibit will feature 30 recent works of calligraphy by artists locally and abroad. The exhibit represents some of the major trends practiced today, reflecting a diversity of approach as well as celebrating common traditional roots. Consider a special form of calligraphy, sealed images which are carved in stone and usually based on ancient Chinese scripts, have a strikingly modern appeal. A collection of 20 actual seals and their impressions will be included in this exhibit. Please join us at the University Art Gallery, California State University, Dominguez Hills. We look forward to seeing you at our exhibitions and events.
Attention businesses in the South Bay of Los Angeles. The South Bay Resource Network and the South Bay Lone Stones are here to help you grow.
I found out about the South Bay representative in my store and presented the services that they provide.
Yes, since we've opened over 4,000 applicants, we have had 25 now. I've seen one South Bay helped us find the gems and how all these people.
On the business side, Lone Stone provides knowledge training and provides resources for contacts. Also provides a resource for training to hopefully take some of their lessons and train these facilities the classes and areas.
It was just a great experience. The nerds of my stop were always helpful in understanding
the services that you know your business is seeing. South Bay Resource Network is here for you. 7799, or visit our website at southbayresource.net.
The one stop is your resource for business in South Bay.
This is my university.
My name is Bart, and I'm a student of the major. I'm a member of Melbourne City College, and two housing students, helpful faculty, staff, and their amazing programs.
Enrich your life. Increase your learning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in humanities, with a focus on the city's own. This master's degree will be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available. Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636. On this job, safety is my first concern. There's a lot that can go wrong. But fortunately, we have Cal State Dominguez Hills, the only authorized OSHA training center in the Los Angeles area. If you're in need of OSHA certification, or if safety is one of your concerns, call 888-4LA OSHA and learn how to be safe. Remember, safety comes first. Or send us an email at dhtv.csudh.edu.
if you ever happen to miss an episode, you can view any of our past episodes on the archives at youtube.com/CSUDHTV. YouTube.com/CSUDHTV. Okay, after the break, I learned the news for you right there. Now, after the break, I would like to read aloud to you, but since I'm forced to pay, I'm going to let somebody else read aloud for you today. We're going to go online. One of my favorite websites I want to point out to all of you right now, we can get that on the screen. It's called StorylineOnline.net. Again, it's StorylineOnline.net. I'm going to show you on the screen right now what it looks like. And this is an awesome site. What it does is it has all kinds of different award-winning actors reading aloud award-winning books. So today we're going to listen to actor Hector Elizondo read the wonderful book, Somebody Loves You, Mr. Ash. It's about an 11.5-minute read aloud. And again, the website is storylineonline.net. Okay, so let's just dive right into it right now. Here you go for this one. And it has closed hands.
Hello, I'm Hector Elizondo. You're watching Storyline Online, brought to you by the Screen Actors Guild Foundation and Book Pals. Today I'll be reading something special. A very special story of a favorite of my granddaughter, while she was in school, of course. Somebody Loves You, Mr. H, is the story today. And it's written by Eileen Stanley, illustrated by Paul Jones. Mr. Hatch was cold and absent, and he did not smile. Every morning at 6:30 sharp, he would leave his brick house to walk 8 blocks to ensure his dad knew where he worked. At lunchtime, he was still alone in the cold. He just chewed and was himself, and drank a cup of coffee. Sometimes, he brought food for dinner. Afterward, he would make just absent. At the museum, at the theater, and at the grocery store, to buy a fresh turkey wing for his supper. After supper, he read the paper, took a shower, and went to bed early. He keeps to himself. That is what everyone was saying about Mr. Hatch. Well, one Saturday, when Mr. Hatch stepped onto the porch of his dusty old room, to his surprise, a package wrapped in brown paper. He had never spoken to most of them before. And I knew Mr. Cooper, he said. Mr. Cooper smiled. You're welcome. I always enjoy delivering packages. Mr. Hatch tore the brown paper off. Inside was a white box, which he opened to find another box. This one was heart-shaped. It was all semi red and bow on top. It was filled with a candy. Something fluttered to the porch floor as a little white collie picked up and said, Somebody loves you. Only then did I remember that this was the Valentine's Day of Mr. Hatch of London. I didn't know who sent this to me. It was all alone. He had no friends. And yet someone had sent it a Valentine. He put the box on the coffin table and tried to do some dusting, but every time he left the room, he had to keep peeking to see if the box was still there. He dusted and dusted, and the dust cloth seemed to whisper, Somebody loves you. Somebody loves you. At last, he flung the dust cloth away and exclaimed, I have got a secret admirer. And then he did something he had never done before. He laughed. And clapped his hands, and then he took a piece of candy from the box and ate it. Mr. Hatch had changed his shirt without his own aftershave and a bottle curl. He splashed it on his face and picked out a yellow tie with blue polka dots and put it on. And then he went for a walk. Maybe, he thought, I will meet the person who sent me the candy. Of course, no one had ever seen Mr. Hatch wearing a tie or smelling of aftershave or all smiling. So he got a lot of attention. This is me, I'm over and over. Mr. Dunwoody nearly fell off his ladder, and little Tina Fey spilled all the toys out of her wagon. The stash waved hello to them all. On Monday, she was back to her bed. At lunchtime, Mr. Hatch, who sat in the middle of the cafeteria, smoked a different one and passed out chocolates from his own box. Although he always usually stopped at the newsstand, Mr. Smith handed him the usual newspaper. I think I'll have a pack of mints, said Mr. Hatch. Not as usual. Mr. Smith was shocked. Was that you speaking, Mr. Hatch? Indeed it was, said Mr. Hatch. I said I would also have mints. And if you don't mind my saying so, Mr. Smith, don't look very well today. Mr. Smith recovered from the shock to reply, you're right, I don't feel very well. I'm cold. I was supposed to go to the doctor's this afternoon, but the staff has been so busy I haven't had the time. Mr. Smith smiled. I'd be happy to watch the staff for you while you go. Mr. Smith could hardly believe his ears. You would? Certainly, just show me what to do. So Mr. Hatch ran the newsstand for an hour. He wondered if any of the women who stopped to buy a paper, or a magazine, or a candy bar, had sent him the mysterious Valentine. So when Mr. Smith returned, Mr. Hatch made his usual stop at the grocery store. I'm a little tired of turkey wings, he told Mr. Todd. I think I'll have a nice, fresh slice of ham. Mr. Todd weighed the meat and wrapped it. You look worried, said Mr. Hatch. I am, said Mr. Todd. My little girl is late. She hasn't come home from school yet, and I can't leave the store to look for her until my wife arrives. Goodness. Why didn't you say so, said Mr. Hatch. I will go look for her. And so he walked to school and found little Melody tied by the strings and brought her home. Thank you, said the girl. Anytime, said Mr. Hatch. Supper, Mr. Hatch did not bother to eat dinner. He decided to bake brownies instead. It would be nice to have brownies to share the next day with the people at the Shoeys factory. As he baked, the warm chocolate smell of brownies floated through the neighborhood and shivered and howled Mr. Hatch's house in the air. I suppose the factory can wait, said Mr. Hatch as he looked out the window. And he brought out two handfuls. Now, what are brownies without a lead? He said, and he stirred up a nice cold leader. When the parents came to gather their children, they had some brownies too. It turned out to be a picnic in Mr. Hatch's backyard. He dusted off an old top bonnet and played songs he remembered from his boyhood. Everyone danced. And so the days and weeks went on. When Mr. Hatch wasn't smiling, he was laughing. When he wasn't laughing, he was helping someone. And when he wasn't helping someone, he was having a party in his yard or on his porch. He seemed to have forgotten about the friend of the person who sent him to Valentine. Then, one afternoon, Mr. Goober of Christmas came to his door, suspicious, very serious. Come in, Mr. Goober, said Mr. Hatch. You look upset. I am upset. I made a mistake some time ago. My supervisor is very angry with me.
Yes, Mr. Goober, what is it?
Do you recall the package I delivered to you on Valentine's Day, I think it was? Yes, I believe so, replied Mr. Hatch, beginning to feel a little uneasy. I don't suppose you still have it, said Mr. Goober. As a matter of fact, said Mr. Hatch, I still have the box. The candy's gone, no? Why do you ask? The postman took a deep breath. I'm afraid I delivered it to the wrong address. I was supposed to go to another house. Mr. Hatch recalled tearing off the brown paper. It had never occurred to him to look at the address. Well, he fetched a heart-shaped box and the big bow and gave it to the postman. I do hope your supervisor won't be too angry with you. The postman was heading down the sidewalk when Mr. Hatch called from his porch.
Mr. Goober, I forgot something.
He gave the postman
What is it? What are you saying? Nobody loved me after all. Then I read the paper, took a shower, and went to bed early. The next morning at 6:30 sharp, Mr. Ash left his brick house along 8 miles to the shooting factory. At lunchtime, he sat in the corner by himself. He ate his cheese and mustard sandwich and drank a cup of coffee. After work, he stopped at the newsstand for his paper, but he did not speak to Mr. Smith. And when he ordered his turkey wing from Mr. Todd, he did not smile. Nor did he pat little Melanie Todd on the head, or big brains, or have big disappointment of place over on him, or very long strip. What is wrong with Mr. Ash? Mr. Goldberg, those mental. We love Mr. Ash, Sister, Mr. and Mrs. Edwin. He gives flowers for our garden. He helps mend our back fence. Mrs. Wheeler nodded. He saved his bones for my dog, Murphy Mart. She loved Mr. Ash, too. Mr. Smith told everyone how Mr. Ash had washed his nose stand so he could visit the doctor. Mr. Todd told everyone how Mr. Ash had found his little girl. All the children in the neighborhood remember Mr. Ash's wonderful brownies and lemonade. Most of all, his laughter. Poor Mr. Ash, I said. What can we do? And Mr. Cooper announced. On Saturday morning, Mr. Ash woke to a bright and sunny day. He put on his old overalls and went out to the porch with his dustpan and hood. He couldn't believe his eyes. All over the porch were red and white hearts and paper bowls. There were boxes of candy on the chairs and yellow streamers flowing from the ceiling and sticking up out of his mailbox was a shiny and silver harmonica. The front yard was filled with people. Happy, smiling people. They were holding up a huge sign with hand-painted letters. It said, "Everybody loves Mr. Ash." Mr. Ash dabbed at a tear with his handkerchief. "I do believe," he said, "somebody loves me after all." And then he smiled. And then he laughed. And then he hurried down to meet his parents. Well, if you don't like that, you don't like that dark chocolate thing. That's it. You know what I mean?
That is such a fantastic, it's a great website. Carlos, I'm a great read. I love him. And what a great book, man. That's what we should be doing to encourage our kids to speak and listen. I mean, get a great conversation after you read that book. I mean, now the kids have something great. I mean, there's nothing better than a good read aloud, folks. I mean, like I said before, I'll say it again. You want to get your students to be better in school, read aloud to them all the time. And I don't care if you are a 12th grade teacher, you read them, somebody loves you, Mr. Ash. If you want to have the attention of 12th graders for that book, then you're doing something wrong. That's just a wonderful, wonderful storybook. And that's what we're asking you today, is to share your stories about what are some of the things that you or some of your best teachers ever did to encourage you to speak and to listen in class. Just give us a call at 1-800-339-1193 or send us an email at dhtv.csudh.edu. So we're talking all about listening instruction. Here's things that we can do before, during, and after instruction. Before listening, it depends on a variety of different aspects, such as the aim, the text type, the level of the students, all kinds of things. It's useful to encourage students to think about and discuss what they're going to hear. You always want to preview things. This is going to help out any kid, but especially an ESL student. You want to give kids the big picture. Now, did any of you ever see the movie The Karate Kid? Did you ever see The Karate Kid, which is a great movie? Jim Thomas Reilly was not that good of a teacher. Because Dan Slott was like, "I'm on your slave, man!" And Mr. Reilly was like, "Show me, wax on, wax off." He's like, "Wax on, wax off." He's like, "No, wax on, wax off." And Dan Slott was like, "Oh,
he's learning karate. Dude, Mr. Miyagi, if you're a good teacher, you know, before you have to get into all your housework, just say these simple repetitive motions you're going to be practicing. And the same motions that you need to master karate. But how often do you walk into classrooms and you watch a teacher and he or she is teaching some skills to students? Telling kids why they need to know these skills. You know, I swear, half the kindergartners in this country have no idea why they're there. They're in class like, what's going on, ma'am? Mom kind of just dropped me off here one day. You know, the kids in on the same grade. Well, so, game up pretty new. What's going on? You know, it's a great idea before listening to use prompts. Also, prompts are a great way to see visuals. Souvenirs. I think souvenirs are fantastic. One of my favorite teachers of all time has got the name of Fred Rogers, Mr. Rogers, and Mr. Rogers. He'd be on TV and he'd do something like this. He'd go, now, all he did was take some simple prop and got my attention immediately. Again, we go to kindergarten, got the Schwarzenegger's first day teaching his kids all crazy, he has no control whatsoever. So Schwarzenegger, he runs out to his car, gets his pet fair, runs back into the classroom, his pet fair, and kids go from this to, what's that? Okay, what is that prop? What is that souvenir? What is that artichoke that gets kids to remember the lesson every single day? It's a great before listening exercise, and it's always a good idea for ASL students to clone into some preview vocabulary. What are some of the words that we're going to be learning that we've never had any kind of exposure to before? You know, when we're trying to listening in English, with all kinds of nuances, just like some of the Blue Panther clips. So this next clip is going to be from the wonderful movie Singing in the Rain. I can't believe Singing in the Rain didn't win Best Picture. You know what, Best Picture? The year Singing in the Rain was up. Singing in the Rain was up for Best Picture. It lost out to the greatest show on Earth, which I heard Steven Spielberg say that was one of his favorite movies as a kid, which amazes me. I think it must just be a time issue, because I saw the greatest show on Earth after watching The Ten Commandments the first week. The greatest show on Earth that cracks me up, because The Ten Commandments, you see that every day. It'll be on ABC next week for Easter every year. I watch it every single year. It's the best 4 hours of my life every single year. It's great, though. The same people who did The Ten Commandments, that's me, the animal, Charles, and that's everybody, the narrator, they did The Greatest Show on Earth, so it's great. So instead of talking about Moses leading his people to the promised land, you have a guy talking that same way, but talking about they call it the Big Top, and they circus under just the suit, and then there's like a Jerry Springer plays a clown, and there's a train accident, but he was a surgeon, and Jarvis has is like, I think I need a blood transfusion, and Jerry Springer's like, it's a whole new movie, but that one, Best Picture, he has something in the rain, and he didn't mind it, and drives me nuts, so, I know, I'm sorry, you got me off track, I got myself off track, so anyway, we're gonna do two clips, this first clip, by the way, from Singing in the Rain, this is the diction move for Lena Lamont once they start going to, use this for speaking and listening, because if you ever see Singing in the Rain, you have to go out and get that movie right now, but Singing in the Rain movie is about, silent movies and transition into talkies, and trying to take some of the silent movie stars and make them into talking movie stars. And so, Lena Lamont, who's kind of this obnoxious actress with a sweet little voice, they're trying to train her to sound elegant. And so, this is a fun little clip with Lena Lamont and her diction coach, so, like, 40 seconds. Enjoy it from Singing in the Rain.
Now, ta te ti to tu.
Ta te ti to tu.
No, no, Miss Lamont, Brown Jones, Brown Jones. Now let me read your line.
And I can't stand him.
And I can't stand him.
And I can't stand him.
Can't.
that is such a wonderful movie. The actor was incredible. This made me want to watch that.
I'll watch that clip, but Denise Rodriguez, Denise writes, and I've always been a shy person, so my teacher would throw a stuffed animal and ask a question. The student that got the stuffed animal would answer it, and the student would throw it to another student, and so on. I think that's a great idea. That's something I've seen too. And I wonder if the body parts we would play Slim and Says. These are right. I mean, this is a great way to get the kids up and moving. It's not very intimidating. She's creating a very good, relaxed environment. Thanks for sharing that, Denise. I appreciate that. We use more strategies that the SL students and teachers can use to prepare for a listening experience. You want to activate students' existing knowledge about whatever the subject is. And you want to build that prior knowledge as well. So they don't have a lot of previous experience then. Our job as teachers is to create those shared experiences and build upon those. You can review your standards for listening, setting kids up. Okay, what are some good habits in listening? Maybe have a piece of paper, take some notes, to really focus your attention. These are some good habits. Establish the purpose for listening. It's different if you're listening for information that's important versus just a conversational tone. Listen very closely. What are you going to remember from this? I know I've given instructions a million times, and I thought they were important, but obviously the people that were listening to them didn't think they were important because they didn't follow those instructions. So one of the things I used to do in my classroom is I had a taped off area, a little red box on my floor, and it was the hot box. And whenever I stepped in that hot box, the kids knew they needed to pay attention because it was very important information. Now, one teacher's like, what are you going to say is important? I'm like, actually, it really is most of the time. But every now and then, there's something that's very important that kids need to remember. So by physically having an area where the kids can focus, this is very important. So like on this show, a lot of people say, oh, what's important is the rhythm and story, because that's what we need for our midterm and our final. That might be influential. I throw magic board at different points in the show, so people actually have to watch the show. And then using a listening guide can also be helpful for students. I have something to read along. I like that old story line online.net. When I turn this on, it was great, and they'll send closed captioning, so you're able to follow along that way while you're listening. During listening, the ESL teachers can provide students with outlines that'll help them for taking notes and things like that. And, another good thing about that, the televised classes, this format, it annoys a lot of students, but there is one real benefit to having a televised class is, if you didn't quite get something, you can watch it over and over and over again. That's something that you couldn't get if you were taking a class on campus. That's really beneficial because a lot of students in this class are usually ESL students that haven't had a lot of English exposure, so they get the concepts a couple of times that way. So that's actually a benefit to a televised class. Whatever your kids, they can write, they can draw, they can repeat, they can perform, all kinds of different things. I'm going to show you a website I like that really is one of my favorite ESL websites. I'm going to show you this website. It's actually called ESL-lab.com. And there's the website. Thank you, Nick, for putting that up. It's ESL-lab.com. It's a really good website because it has all kinds of different listening courses for it. It's a whole site. And so, what it'll do is it has different types of dialogues, easy dialogues, medium-level dialogues, and difficult dialogues, and it has quizzes for each one. It gives you before, during, and after exercises. So let's just be an one. We'll do an answering machine one. So the answering machine, so you see it has a pretty easy exercise for the answering machine. Then it has the listening exercise itself with questions that you can guide along. And then it has vocabulary activities and post-listening exercises. That's a really cool website. It's free of charge. And then here we'll listen to it. We'll do the listening exercise right now.
Hey Bill, this is Hank. I'm just calling to let you know that I'll be a little late to the game tomorrow night. I have to work a few extra hours to finish a report. I should wrap things up sometime between 7 and 8 though. Oh, and I'm planning on dropping by Lisa's house for about an hour since she's been sick recently. phone came over, they all swing by my house to pick up some food for me. See them?
I guess that's a pretty basic dialogue there. It's not really dialogue, it's an answer machine message, but you get the idea that way. It's a pretty good site. So tsl-lab.com is really helpful. Just another thing, without getting stupid, the different word, and different word from Sam and Lorraine. This is Gene Hannah, Gene Kelly, the great Gene Kelly, with Donald Connor, with their addiction coach. Just a little 3-minute clip, and it's a song. And a song, so from Sam and Lorraine.
Moses, he supposes I'm Moses. But Moses supposes me erroneously. Moses, he knows he supposes I'm Moses. As Moses supposes he supposes to be. Moses supposes his toes are roses, but Moses supposes erroneously. But Moses, he knows his toes are roses, as Moses supposes his toes to be. Moses supposes his toes are roses, but Moses supposes erroneously. A Moses, a Moses, a rose is a rose, a toes is a toes. Oop-de-o-de-doodle. Moses supposes his toes are roses, but Moses supposes erroneously. A Moses, he knows his toes are roses, but Moses supposes his toes to be.
Moses,
Moses,
get the kids up and moving. That's what we're going to do, dance to. Also, I wanted to see Sandy and Lorraine's story for you. So we have really focused on listening up until this point. But speaking and listening are intricately linked. And one of the things that we want to really try and do as teachers is to promote lots of authentic forms of communication, get the kids talking in natural circumstances. So lots of role-playing activities, lots of small group work, lots of partner, things like that. Something I really try to point out to teachers, though, is really a focus on grammar, especially when it's speaking and listening, because that's a waste of time. And there are very few, I think there's only three people that actually speak properly. Those are God, James Earl Jones, and Gregory Peck. They're the only three people that have actually ever spoken properly. Because if you ever, like, you know, you can watch a whole program, say, for transcripts of Food Honors in Houston, New Jersey, if you ever actually looked at one of those transcripts of how we talk, we talk very differently than we write. You know, so it's like, it says, Oprah, so when did you meet Katie? Tom.
Oh, I'm in love. She's so great.
That's not all of this sound all the time. I sound like an idiot half the time. is when you guys have more time to process the information and think, because I speak quickly if I spoke slower and thought out every specific thing. Maybe President Obama needs a little more, you know, he's like, what we are trying to do in the healthcare area, he's thinking much more than me. I always just kind of say whatever comes to my head. So, you want to, before speaking, again, you can give kids outlines, but before speaking about anything, if you're having the kids do any kind of presentation, you want to make sure that the kid has plenty of time to rehearse and prepare. Rehearse and prepare. I'm a big fan of Reader's Theater. What I'll do is I'll give the kids a piece of writing on Monday, and over the week, every single day, they practice on that piece of writing with a friend, and on Friday, they present it to the class, so they've had plenty of time to prepare for that Reader's Theater. Now, while speaking, I always prefer to do things informally, you know, like a loose atmosphere. You know, because Drew Cycle used to do a great routine where he said that America's number one fear is public speaking. Number two is death. So if you ever go to a funeral, people would rather be in the casket than delivering the eulogy. And it's a truth. It's not easy to make presentations from large groups of people. When a person does leave and see an ESL student, I hear a lot of teachers that freak out about correct pronunciation and correct vocabulary and things like that. You know, you go for people, all the language is communication. You know, it drives me. You're at a party and you're like, oh yeah, I've been there often. And a person's like, it's not often, it's pronounced often. You've been around for something like that. What do you think about people like that? Do you want to hang out with people like that all the time? So don't be that person. You know, let it go. Let it go. Usually what I do to people, how do you let it go? I'll tell you why. Because I have kids, it's with Thomas Longshank. And what I do is what's called reformulation. I just reformulate what they just said, but in the proper form. So if the kid says, what time is lunch? I'll say, what time is lunch? Lunch is at 11:15. Again, if you do this without making the kid feel miserable about themselves, and then, again, after speaking, you know, after kid speaks, have people write and draw about what they spoke about, things like that, okay? I love watching different teachers. It's a nice clip. I'm going to show you. Actually, it's about a 16-minute clip. I'm trying to expose you to lots of different teachers. This teacher is a second-grade teacher in Arkansas, Mr. Smith. And he, like me, is a big believer in music and really doing a lot of seeing his kids. And you're going to see his kids are happy. They're having a great time. They're learning lots of different things. This is just how he begins his day with the calendar. So this is less than a half-minute clip, but it's Mr. Smith's morning class meeting routine. Enjoy this 6.5 minute clip.
Tomorrow, I love you. Tomorrow. Doesn't mean giving less work to the kids that are not at a high level and more work to the kids.
things that are at a high level now. It means giving different types of work to those types of kids. The kids that are working at a higher level, they want things that challenge them a little bit more. And the kids at a lower level, they need lots of reinforcement, lots of practice, repetition, things like that. So that's what you have to keep in mind. So some round games and activities can be very useless. A lot more in your evening, too, by the way. Like charades. I love charades because it allows kids to participate non-verbally. But we're talking speaking on the same day, so I like doing puppetry. Why do I like puppetry more than anything? A lot of kids are intimidated speaking in front of other kids, but you put a little sock puppet on their hand, put a cardboard box in front of their face, and let them in to see everybody. Well, all of a sudden, this kid now can talk like crazy. Talking. You can do chain of motions. What we'll do is form our circle of life. I used to form our circle or circle of life after the Lion King. Kids not able to sing every day. And what the chain of motions does is we'll say, we'll start with Acacia. Acacia, her motion is just going under water. Okay, so it's soon as Pablo. So Pablo, he has to repeat Acacia's motion. Water and Pablo goes like this, like an arrow from a new heart. Okay, so now it gets to Loretta's turn. So she has to repeat. Acacia's going underwater, Pablo's doing this, and now Loretta, she goes, yeah, something like that. You do that with all the kids in the classroom. It's a fun activity. You're doing motions, you're getting the kids talking, things like that. Awesome. This is one of my favorite ones. You'll have some students that are performing without talking, and you have another student who takes like a pencil, and they act like a news reporter on the scene, and they're describing the action of whatever the kids are performing. That's the dance. The new feed gets all the kids laughing and talking, and, you keep on talking about that laughter, getting the kids laughing as much as possible, and get them laughing. They're going to talk. They want to talk about those experiences. And that's really something that's very important. Get them laughing as much as possible. Storytelling. I remember we emailed Ben about doing stuff to animals. It was a good idea. The place you can have the kids is Auntie Beanie Baby. And I did start off a story, I believe, about Once Upon a Time and Three Little Bears. I threw it to a kid. Let's say Jesus. Pictures it. Jesus is like, there was a papa bear, a mama bear, and a mother-in-law bear, and Jesus, he throws it to Tanisha, and Tanisha's like, yeah, and mother-in-law bear, she has papa bear below, she had a towel, and then she throws it over to Mario, and Mario's like, yeah, papa bear said, well, you can stop getting on the bed, and then I'm gonna jump on her, but we're going for this brand new story. Again, I want the kids laughing, I want them talking about this story, I'm making it a lot of fun. Animal tending, we're not going to do that. Poetry. I talked about poetry earlier, now we only have a couple minutes left here, but I think poetry is one of the most important ways to get your kids up and talking, so I'm constantly having the kids create their own poems, and you have to expose kids lots of different types of poetry. There's acrostics, there's simplifies, there's basic rhymes, there's numbers, there's haiku. I've always told the kids, if you don't know what kind of poem you wrote, just call it free verse, because there's no rules whatsoever to free verse. And so one of the things I used to do is we had a thing called coffee house night for parents. And the kids would dress up in turtlenecks and berets, and we made coffee for the parents in the classroom. We had a microphone. We did a jam session with all the poems that we had created. One of the best ones I ever got was Tiger Elegant's and Thin Ones. It was like, recess. So fevers. You gotta watch the world with the all this stuff for the shortcut all the time. Get the kids play lots of different poetry games. I'm doing Cole Hunter right now in the road. I'd be like, ladies and gentlemen, tonight we're looking for the haiku. The haiku is extremely rare. It comes to us from Japan. Can anybody find a haiku in this class? So the kids are looking around and talking and giggling and stuff like that. But yeah. Just the theme I'm trying to give you, there's to bring back the joy into the classroom, get those kids smiling. The more smiling and laughing and playing, the more they're going to talk. The more they talk, the better they're going to improve their language acquisition. I'm so sorry, my voice is shot this week. I have 2 weeks off now. I promise you in 2 weeks, I should, I hope, I'm sound a lot better. So, folks, make sure you have a wonderful spring break or Easter break, and I'll see you back here in 2 weeks. As you're going to class, just make sure you have your next assignment posted within 2 weeks, and I will be seeing you in 2 weeks. Until then, folks, remember, you make a difference each and every day in the lives of your children. You have a wonderful weekend. Enjoy the sunshine, and I will see you here in a couple of weeks, everybody. Have a wonderful weekend. Bye-bye. I'm gonna go get some more.